Hello, welcome to our service today. It's wonderful to be able to share with you. The prophet Isaiah speaks of God forming light and darkness and working through those things too, having things to reveal to us and show us that God has for us, both out of light and treasures that are hidden away in darkness. Our opening hymn picks up on some of that for us. It's a hymn which has become linked with Shetland in my mind, having read Stella Shepherd's book about her time on Papastour, which she called Like a Mantle the Sea, a line which she took from this hymn, O Worship the King, All Glorious Above. Let us pray. God of the wind, come, breathe over us. Breathe your spirit into our minds and show us your glory. God of the sun, give us your warmth today. Warm our hearts with your love and your grace. God of the storms, hold us as we come with the various challenges we have faced this week. Offer us the protection that we need. God, we come to you. We come to fellowship with you, to hear from you, to offer our praises, and to offer our confessions. And so as we come, we lay at your feet The joys and blessings of this week for which we wish to give thanks, hold them to you and honour you as we name them in our minds. Lord, we come in confession, holding before you those hurts of this week, the hurts others have given us, and the hurts that we have inflicted as well. We ask for your strength to forgive others, but also for your forgiveness to us. So, Lord, in a moment of quietness, we name these things to you for which we wish to say sorry. God of all creation, who speaks and by whose voice and word things are done, let us hear afresh your word of grace, that in you, all those who truly repent, our sins are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Isaiah 45, verses 1 to 7. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped to subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and the gate shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen, I call you by your name. I surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. May the Lord bless this reading.
Hello, everybody. I wonder how you're coping with this COVID. I nearly said COVID carry on, but you came what I mean. Maybe you're like me, sometimes coping fine, sometimes not so fine. In other words, sometimes up and sometimes down. We miss so much family, seeing them, giving them a hug. And isolation is even worse for some folk. At least I can go outside here on the craft, which is good, and I'm thankful for that. But I find that the weather plays a big part on how I cope with it. Sunshine, blue sky, and you really feel well, life is okay. But no long ago, maybe 10 days ago, and then we had several days of really drich weather. Mist and drush, and you could hardly see any distance at all. And I find that has the effect of making you feel more isolated is what you would normally. And also, it can maybe also make you more anxious about things that's been on your mind. You can concerns about your family. I had two grandparents down at Glasgow University, and they were right into lockdown. I just so felt for them, you can. Anyway, one of these really poor days, I was feeling quite down. I just thought, I can't shut this feeling off. I just feel, how am I going to cope with this? And I thought, well, I could make a cup of tea. A cup of tea sometimes cheers you up. Or I could phone a friend And then I thought, well, I shouldn't have unloaded my worries on a friend that maybe his worries are the rain. And then a few words slid into my mind, and it was, practice what you preach. Practice what you preach. And the next thought I had was, Jesus is my friend. Jesus is my friend. And there and then I just sat down and I just unloaded all the things that I felt was making me feel so low, and just sharing it with Jesus in a very simple way. And after I'd done that, and then I checked through that lovely hymn, let me see if I can mind the first verse. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, but peace we often forfeit. Oh, but needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Well, it was still musty and wet outside, and none of the things I'd been worrying about had been settled in any way, but I just felt so much I was not alone, and I was sharing with somebody that could carry my concerns, and he would not leave me alone. And that was a great assurance. Thank you.
The reading is from Matthew 22, verses 15 to 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him along with Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" And they answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. Amen.
Some things are clearly right and some things are clearly wrong, although the number of those things might be fewer than we imagine. Some of you will know of Richard Wurmbrand, who was a Romanian pastor who was imprisoned by the communist regime in the middle of the 20th century. Ended up in solitary confinement underground in awful conditions. And he had time to reflect on his faith and had all sorts of things come to him, some of which were written down after his release. In this book of his sermons that he wrote, the first is entitled with the intriguing name, God's Unjust Laws, in which he reflects on the Ten Commandments as well as a phrase from the prophet Ezekiel: "I gave them statutes that were not good and judgments whereby they should not live." And he says things such as, "Well, thou shalt not kill," is said to a Swede or a Swiss whose nation has known no war for centuries. We Romanians have had the same commandment, although our country has often been invaded by foreigners in every generation. We've had to defend ourselves. "Thou shalt not steal" is said to the billionaire who has more than he will ever need and has no reason to steal. "I am terribly hungry and I would steal bread if only I could find it. But in doing this, God, I would be breaking one of your unjust laws." "Thou shalt bear no false witness" is said is a law for the man who has no reason to lie, or perhaps is not even able to do so. "It is also a law for me, who has to answer the communist interrogator, and if I tell the truth, as he asks me, appealing to my Christian obligation, many other arrests will follow." And so he goes on through the various Ten Commandments, pointing out how, given the context in which someone finds themselves, some of those are heard in very different ways. And even those which we might think of as clearly right or wrong might not be the case. With a billionaire, although one might, and him as a without any bread, one might legally be on the right side of things and one might illegally be stealing. But there's also that question of who is morally the thief in that situation, of the one who has gathered more than could possibly be spent in a lifetime, than the person who steals a piece of bread, where law and morality don't seem to fit together. Ethics finds itself in a strange place. We find that there are situations where it's a bit ambiguous what the right or the wrong bit of behaviour is. And that can be from rather small, mundane things all the way through to some very big things. I took my car in for its MOT last week, and what I normally do in these situations is leave the car at the garage, go into the town, find a cafe, sit down in a cafe with a cup of tea and a snack, and read a book. Context has changed since I last had MOT. Got into town and I had to come up with a decision. Do I go into a cafe and support a local business which has gone through a really difficult few months and could really perhaps do with the support. You might see that as a very good thing. But doing so, I have to take myself away from the outside where the air is clearest and cleanest and go inside into a place where people can remove their masks and would be complicit in increasing the risk of any transmission of COVID or other illnesses between people. Not that I had the virus, but by gathering, I could be complicit in passing it on if someone passes it to me and I were then to cough. What's the right thing to do in that situation? Do we support the local business, which is doing all it can with the current regulations, but with the possibility of being involved in increased risk of infection? Or do we not do that? And what are the implications for both of those? What's the ethically right thing to do? What would you do in that situation? As I say, I suspect some of you would choose to go into the cafe, others of you would not, and feel both justified that you made the right decision. On a bigger level, the Channel Islands were the only bit of the British Isles occupied during the Second World War. And the story that gets told these days is, on the one hand, of those engaged in the resistance, who, you know, stood up against these occupiers, and saw something different that could be done. And there were those, there's the story of the collaborators who colluded and were in cahoots with the Nazi occupying force. If history had gone differently and the occupation had not ended in May 1945, well then perhaps we wouldn't hear of resistance and collaborators. We would hear of aggravators and peacemakers. Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers. Who in the situation of occupation is the peacemaker? Who is doing the right thing? Is it the person who we see as the resistance, fighting against what is the perceived injustice, actively doing things which may not be very peaceful in hopes of a future time of peace? Or is it the people who make peace in the here and now? Jesus was living in a time of occupation under the Roman Empire. And, as is the case in the Channel Islands in the Second World War and other situations of occupation today, there were a number of different responses. Who was right? We have the Herodians, those who support King Herod, who is a client king under the auspices of the Roman Empire, paying their dues to keep peace and have a sense of what they consider to be normal, even if that means having to be blinded to some of the things going on. We have the Pharisees, who retreat into their own piety and say, we're not going to get involved in that, we're going to just diligently follow God's laws and stick to exactly what the Bible says, and try and retreat into our religiosity and a sense of righteousness that we can get from there. There are others, such as some of those in Jesus' own disciples, the zealots, who went around with weapons on them, ready for the big battle with Rome. You might remember at Jesus' arrest, Simon cuts off the ear of one of the slaves of the Roman centurions. Someone ready for violent, non-peaceful resistance. Who is right? One of the ways this plays out is paying the taxes to the occupying force. Should you or should you not do that? Should you resist that, as people throughout history have sought to resist paying taxes for things they consider unjust or inappropriate uses of what they see as their money? Or should you pay the tax and try and keep peace that way? Jesus, what's the right thing to do? Come some people who do not agree. Are you going to say you're on our side or their side? Jesus, whose side are you on? Whose side is Jesus on? Perhaps that's not the right question, though, is it? Jesus, whose side are you on? Shouldn't the question rather be, am I on Jesus' side? Am I on God's side in this situation? Isn't that what we should be asking? Well, perhaps. But that might just be the other question worded slightly differently. The Herodians thought they were on God's side, doing the right thing to keep peace there, to enable the temple functions to still go, so that people could do God-given righteous things as laid out in God's law. The Pharisees thought they were on God's side, doing the right thing, responding in the correct way to this awful set of circumstances. The zealots thought they were doing the right thing. They were on God's side, ready with, you know, good scriptural backing behind them, that being prepared to fight for the land and all that sort of thing was what God would want. Three very different responses. People all saying, no, we're on God's side. And perhaps if we jump quickly from, am I on God's side? Yes, I am. Without being challenged about what we're doing, we might really not actually be seeing if we're on God's side, but just justifying to ourselves the opposite, that God might be on our side. Keeping peace is God's way. Fighting for the land is God's way. These things come into conflict, though. And when we do that, when we jump quickly into saying, yes, I'm on God's side, without seeing how God might be calling us to do something different, perhaps we're jumping over the opportunity to be surprised or challenged by God and actually change as God calls us. If we think we've got it all sussed out, we've got God all neatly wrapped up, there's nothing more to be said. Isaiah 45 is one of the most shocking and challenging passages in the Bible. And if it doesn't shock us and challenge us, we need to take a step back to hear that challenge and surprise again. God, at the beginning of that chapter, says, Cyrus, you are my Messiah. Cyrus, the Gentile, the pagan emperor of Persia, described as the anointed one of God, the Messiah. We should pause there and let that challenge hit us. To anyone who thinks they've got God sussed out, there's a side blow that we weren't expecting, glancing us out the way. A side blow there that challenges us as God sidesteps our expectations of exactly what God is like and the way God is going to work and who God is going to use to achieve his purposes. And then we get this another surprise that God says he will reveal treasures of darkness, or treasures out of the darkness, sidestepping any simplistic notions that we might have of light, good, where God is, darkness, ooh, bad, where God is not. We have here this unexpected person being told that they will go to an unexpected place and discover treasures and God being there. God there as a treasure in the dark place. Yesterday I heard the news that a friend of mine and three of her four children died in a car crash. My family, our friends and plenty of people around the country are in a very dark place because of that. But in that dark place, God is there. Sidestepping any expectation that people may have had that through in sadness and death, God is not there, but God is only to be found in rejoicing. Richard von Brand was in a very dark place and found God to be there. God sidesteps our expectations. God sidesteps our desires to claim him as being ours to the exclusion of others. God sidesteps in Jesus the riches of heaven so that we might know them. Jesus sidesteps life that we might have it in abundance. Jesus sidesteps this ambiguous ethical situation here with the Romans looking on with the possibility of it all flaring up. He sidesteps all of that and leaves open the door that we might be surprised and challenged by God. They were amazed and they went away. And this event was told and retold. And others have been challenged and surprised and have drawn near.
Father, hear the prayer we offer, not for ease that prayer shall be, but for strength that we may ever live our lives courageously. Not forever in green pastures do we ask our way to be, but the steep and rugged pathway may we tread rejoicingly. Not forever by still waters would we idly rest and stay, but would strike the living fountains from the rocks along our way. Be our strength in hours of weakness, in our wanderings be our guide, through endeavor, failure, danger, Father, be there at our side.
Let us turn to pray for others, for the church, for the world, and those near and dear to us. Let us pray.
God, our friend, we come before you with our burdens of prayer, trusting in you to hear with a merciful ear. We pray for your church here and around the world. Pray for your strength for our witness and your guidance with all the ethical ambiguities we may find ourselves called to respond to. Lord, lead us and help us continue to hear your voice. With all that's happening, God, with the COVID pandemic, we pray for our governments, that you would give them the leadership and wisdom and guidance they need. We pray for all those scientists who are working on seeking to develop a vaccine, that you would guide that process too, that this pandemic might come to an end. And we pray for all those whose physical or mental health has suffered, directly or indirectly, as a result of the restrictions and the illness that's going around. We pray for all those who are grieving today, processing information of deaths of friends and family, all those who are seeking the treasures of darkness. Lord, we pray that you would reveal them. God, in the quietness of our hearts, we name before you the people and places that are dear to us in need of your blessing today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers which we offer to you in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Thank you for sharing in this service with us. A final prayer before we close our time together. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be the servants of others, as you were the servant of all. For you gave up your life and died for us, but live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. As you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you this day and forever. Amen.